I kind of want to start this second Over the Garden Wall video by sharing some thoughts that I've been having about the stories that we see and the protagonists that we see within them, and how there's kind of two different types of protagonists. There's the passive protagonist that's kind of reacting to things that have happened to them. Think Anne in Amphibia, who is just, her actions are, she's trying to get home. She's trying to fix what has happened to her in transporting her to the frog world. And then there's active protagonists who are looking to do something, who are setting out on a quest, so to speak. Think Steven Universe, trying to get stronger. Think Finn from Adventure Time, that kind of stuff. This one is kind of the first category. This is a very passive story. In rewatching the first couple episodes, I still don't know how these boys got lost in the woods. They were just kind of there and are like, oh, beans, we're lost. Oops. And I don't know if we'll get explanations for that, or if it's something later, or if they just straight up just got lost one day. Who knows? But I was just kind of thinking about that and how kind of mysterious this show is about all that kind of stuff. I have a couple notes for stuff that I've noticed while rewatching stuff. I was trying to figure out like what time period this takes place in, what era, if I can kind of match it to anything. And I haven't really seen any real technology in, it was all like fireplace and lanterns and stuff in the woodsman's hut, in the, I forgot the name of the town, but where the pumpkins were, where the skeleton pumpkins were. I didn't really see any electricity, no cars or anything. Maybe I just missed it, but Wirt did ask for a phone at one point. It's really subtle, really quick. When he walks into the one house where there's the turkey whose head is laying down on the table, he says, excuse me, I was hoping to find a phone, which struck me as weird when I rewatched it, because that's like the first and really only overt reference to technology that we've had. And I think that's really interesting. And I'm wondering if there's something to that. I wonder if I managed to pick up on something cool, or if it's just a line he said. Other than that, so let's see. So there's Wirt and Greg are the boys. Beatrice, I'm really bad with names. I think I've said this during the Hell of a Boss ones, but I'm super, super bad with names. But Beatrice the bird, they noted that she's like really vague about stuff. I'm wondering why she can talk. Granted, this is fantasy world and stuff where there's skeletons wearing pumpkins and stuff in the town, weird beast oil that turns dogs into monsters. So anything can really happen, but she made a very, very specific point to mention, hey, I'm not magic. Definitely not magic. So I wonder, we're gonna find out more about her. I have no reason to not trust her at this moment, but anything can happen. I'm wondering if we are going to see Adelaide, the good woman of the wood that she talked about in the previous episode. She seems to be leading us there. So I'm curious. I don't know what these next two episodes hold in store for me, but I guess we're going to find out soon. But first off, social media plugs, Twitter and Twitch. I'm at HeyTallman at both places, the same as down here. And if you especially follow me on Twitch, I'm trying to up my followers there a little bit. 250 followers, I'm gonna start up a Mother 3 playthrough. It's my favorite game of all time. I've been looking for an excuse to replay it. So at 250 followers, I'm gonna do that. So give me a follow there. If you don't wanna search for it on Twitch, there is a link in the description that'll take you straight to my page. You can just follow me there. Other than that, thank y'all for watching the first episode. I was kinda nervous putting up videos for a new show, but y'all have been watching and liking and commenting quite a bit, so thank you very much for that. Hello to all the new people who found my channel through this. Welcome, glad to have you here. So a pretty good spike in subscribers following that, so thank you. Not wearing any real fall attire today, but I do have a glass of peppermint tea, one of my favorites, because it is nighttime. I'm not going to drink anything with caffeine. Still a little hot for me. I'm like super, super wimpy when it comes to hot stuff. I guess, do you like tea? What's your favorite kind of tea? Let me know. My favorite is Earl Grey, but it has caffeine, like I said. But anyway, all that out of the way, pleasantries and I guess a question of the video. We are about to dive into episode 3 of Over the Garden Wall, if I can speak. School Town Follies. Haven't read the description for this, haven't looked at the thumbnail really. So we are about to go in blind. So let me just get situated over here. Let me scooch a little bit. And we will start episode 3 in 3, 2, 1, go. I do like, it's really calming, this intro that we get every time. I love the strings and everything.
We will go to Adelaide.
I love Greg.
To Adelaide.
He already made up a song about Adelaide.
Join the Adelaide Parade.
No. The Adelaide, Adelaide Parade. It's so
to
cute.
Adelaide. Let's go to Adelaide's house. I need to fix that last part.
Yeah, it didn't rhyme.
I have to.
Wirt sings the really high part.
All right.
That's
but
funny.
We have to do something fun.
You know, we really don't. We can just keep walking silently, you know?
And technically, you're not walking, you're flying.
Let's go, come on.
Sorry.
But what is with the boy's shoe?
Like, don't you want to be more like your brother? Just always doing what you're told?
Huh?
Just a pathetic pushover who relies on others to make all his decisions?
Hey!
She's really coming after him, huh?
That doesn't really sound that fun.
The world is a miserable place, Greg. Life isn't fun.
Facts.
Then I'll do what I need to do, I guess.
We'll just focus on getting you guys to Adelaide's
school.
Interesting.
Not today.
Greg!
I'm gonna pause real quick. Something I forgot to mention is that the first two episodes each reminded me of some kind of horror. The first episode reminded me of Bloodborne. The second one was reminiscent of both like Midsummer and The Wicker Man kind of thing. So I'm really curious to see if we're going to get like a third kind of horror inspiration going for this one and for all future episodes as well. It'd be really cool if we get like a little different flavor of horror each time. I'm all for that.
Once the bell has rung, class has begun.
Oh, sorry, everybody. Sorry.
That almost rhymed.
No, he doesn't have a brain. He can't learn anything. Let's go, Wirt. Come on.
Gosh, she is so savage.
I can't hear you because I'm too busy doing what I'm told.
I thought he was going to say I'm too busy not having a brain. Yeah. Also, does the frog have a new name this episode?
Bluebirds have a short lifespan. You two are literally killing me every moment I'm forced to spend with you.
Oh. Wow.
I got enough nonsense from that no good, two-timey, low-down, handsome man of mine. Oh, Jimmy Brown, what?
Oh, Jimmy Brown.
With my father threatening to close the school and that wild gorilla on the loose.
What?
A is for the apple that he gave to me. B is for beloved that I called to.
Ooh, that lady's got some baggage.
Go to the dunce box.
Well, he already is kind of wearing a dunce cap.
Where were we? Oh, yes.
His head
G
just sticks up through.
Gentleman I thought he
you were on
was.
B, not G.
Hey, I got an idea. Let's play Tooled Cat. Do you guys know how to play Tooled Cat?
I do not, actually.
It's fun. I'll show you. Here we go.
Is it going to be
Here's
fun?
Here's one old cat.
Oh, no.
Another one.
These
Wait,
poor cats.
No.
I don't even like cats, and I just feel super sad.
Sorry, kitty. We'll have to find another old cat. Hey, Jeffrey, I think there's one behind you.
There is a gorilla on the loose.
Quick, in here.
Oh, dear. Stuff's gonna happen.
Wait, meal time. This is way better than being chased by a gorilla.
I'm sorry. I think that's supposed to be a possum. I'm sorry. I know the internet loves possums. Not really a fan.
Oh.
Hashtag incorrect pianos.
Hey, I know what to do. Here, Miss Lang.
I have a thing where I just...
like this.
Hold on. I'm going to pause it right here. I have a thing where I just notice pianos that are wrong. This piano is very, very incorrect. I mean, we have the, you know, the CDE right there with the two black keys there, but the other black keys just make no sense. Nobody can animate a piano correctly. They're always wrong. You notice in like any cartoon, animated show, manga, I noticed in JoJo's one time a piano that had like 8 keys or 9 keys to an octave or something like that, and it was just, it's wrong. Pianos are always wrong everywhere. Why am I like this?
Oh,
Jim, is that her man she was singing
molasses.
About?
If you want want some? Oh, just ask us. They're warm and soft like puppies in socks, filled with cream and candy rocks. Oh, potatoes and molasses.
I wouldn't hate potatoes and molasses, actually. It's not the worst thing I've ever heard of. It's better than the beef fizz.
If you can't see them, put on your glasses. They're shiny and large like a fish.
Oh, there's that ding dang gorilla again. Got him.
And molasses. It's the only thing left on your toes.
Yo, why does this song hit?
That's enough.
Father.
Is this what I've been paying for?
Ooh. That guy's unpleasant.
I didn't invest in a school for fun.
Ah, it's a private school.
Oh, please, Father, don't close the school. It won't happen again.
I should say it won't. This, and this are all coming with me.
This is a weird episode. Like, I have no idea how this, like, fits in with... they're now wearing the night clothes? They're just... Yep, I guess we live here now.
But I just made everything worse.
Sometimes that's how it goes.
Okay, Wirt, I'll admit Ooh. It. You seem like a pushover, but you're not.
Oh.
Deep
Put that hat back
heart,
on, boy.
You're a stubborn jerk. When are you gonna give this up?
Yo, his hair's even Let's shaped like his hat a little day. Bit.
Okay, if you say so.
Let's go save the day. What, by getting the musical instruments back?
Okay, I think he's asleep. Let's go steal his stuff.
Let's go rob an old man.
The instruments. They've been stolen. Who would do such a thing? Huh?
Aw. Hey, more people. Like, adults, actually.
What
That's weird.
Is this?
Did was steal my heart away.
Is that the gorilla?
Gorilla!
Young man, do something. Whoa!
Is it Jimmy Brown? It's Jimmy Brown! Let's go!
That's right, darling. I was the gorilla.
Oh.
Darling.
Yeah. What a weird one.
I guess the world really is as sweet as potatoes and molasses.
Yeah?
Tie your shoe.
Hmm? Oh.
Yes, please.
Okay.
If your stomach
Granted, your disregard for safety saved the day, but at the same time, tie your ding dang shoe. That's it for this episode. Okay. I managed to pause it right on the... I don't recognize any of the other names for any of the minor characters. Okay. That was episode 3. I feel like I wasn't saying a lot throughout that one. Like I mentioned at one point, it seems kind of fillery, actually. I hate to describe something like that as like filler, but we didn't really... advance the plot, so to speak. We didn't go see Adelaide. We kind of got sidetracked kind of in that old 80s adventure movie kind of way. But as I think I said at one other point, that was, I think, the funniest episode so far. Just the introduction of each like individual plot thread just kept getting zanier and zanier. And just, I don't know, it was just funny. Like, Greg really shined in this one. And it was fun. It was a lot of fun. It's just like, it didn't answer any questions. It didn't bring up any new ones. It just kind of exists. So while I think it's the funniest, it's also, I think, the least intriguing. It also never got horrific. It kind of stuck to just the pure fantasy kind of thing with the animals learning to play musical instruments school, which is a wild concept. Lovely, though. A lot of fun, but yeah, so let us head on now to episode 4, Songs of the Dark Lantern. This one sounds like it might be a little more my speed as far as the content within, hopefully. So let's get started here in 3, 2, 1, go. Oh, it's the old man again. But, like,
oh, no!
We have the flashback filter
on.
Is there a beast out there?
Is this how they got lost?
I didn't see any beast. That driver is nuts.
Well, that's good.
Good. That crazy driver's taking us way off course.
Wait.
Really? Yeah.
All right. So no, this isn't how they got lost. This isn't a flashback.
Well, finally some good luck. Let's go to this creepy tavern and ask for some directions.
Oh. It is a creepy tavern.
It's creepy.
I'm hungry.
Okay, so we do get him again, the woodsman. I was wondering when we were going to see him again, or even if we were.
Oh. Excuse me there.
A cute pupper. Hmm? Oh, I love them.
Well, hey there, Peach Pot. What you doing around? Hey, what's that bird you got there?
I am Beatrice. These two sweet kids and I got a bit lost in the...
Oh! No birds allowed in my tavern. It's a bad omen when a bluebird enters through your door.
Is it? I've never heard that.
Curse you. You'll die someday, and I'll laugh.
Well, she won't be around to see it. Bluebirds have a very short lifespan, I've heard.
He's the butcher.
I'm the butcher.
The baker.
Yeah!
The midwife. The master apprentice. The tailor. And I'm the tavern keeper. Who are you?
I'm hungry.
Is that Spinel? Is that Spinel's voice?
Just sort of like myself, you know?
I'm the highwayman. I make ends meet, just like any man. I'll knock you out, drag you off the road.
Ooh, look at the animation on that dance.
Steal your shoes from off your feet, and then highwayman, when I make ends meet.
He looks... That... I love how that... Alright, hold up. I need to note the animation there, because they managed to do in like 2D style animation. Like, I don't know if this is hand drawn. I don't know anything about the production of this one. It looks very hand drawn. It certainly doesn't look computery. There's not a lot of like fancy stuff going on a lot with the animation, but they managed to do like a fisheye lens, kind of like a super wide angle lens kind of shot with him dancing, whereas when he got like closer to the camera, he got like slightly more distorted and kind of like wobbly during his dance, so to speak. And when he came like really close, you could really tell that like he kind of like spread like out. It's like hard to describe. Let me hold up, let me go back here and see if I can like get a still of it. Here's where I wanted to show it off. See, like, notice how like the beams in the back where the lantern is hanging, like the wood, rather than just being like a straight pillar, it's like they're both like curved a little bit. That's what happens when you have like a super like wide angle lens. Even like the floorboards are kind of like curved as well. Fascinating that they can manage to pull off like a look like that with seemingly just 2D animation. Really impressive animation right there. Really makes you feel that this guy is like yes, he's singing about being a highwayman, he's being a robber, he's wearing like the robber's mask kind of thing, but like even more so than just knowing who he is and what he does, like the animation itself is doing a good job of making you feel like, hey, something's off about this guy. And that's, you know, a really, really good way that they can like show instead of tell, kind of thing. Even though they did tell at the same time that they did showed, they did both in tandem, which is like really powerful. Anyway, let's carry on.
Hey, are you wearing lipstick?
Oh my god, or is it pizza sauce? I was half expecting that horse to just talk. Finally, it might by the end of the episode.
If you knew the way, I'm her name is Adelaide, and...
Oh, it's a girl you're after, eh? Not the witless, simple-minded fool everybody takes you for.
Wow!
The young lover.
What? Young lover? No.
So, notice how Wirt is, he's not asking about how to get home. Like, if it was me and I was lost in the woods...
Or the swoops and sweeps and curls, calligraphers are just a thing to help you win your girl. Then you'll need
sorry,
to
a song started.
Today. There's work for all when little boys get married. That pointy cone upon your head.
Please. All right, before this next verse starts, notice that, so if it was me and I was lost, I would say, I'm lost, I'm trying to get home. Yes, even though we're on our way to find Adelaide, me being a kid seeing adults, I'd say, hey, I'm lost, I'm from such and such place, can you help me get back there? Whereas he's saying, can you help me find Adelaide? It's kind of weird that he's like still on this quest to find the good lady of the wood kind of thing, instead of, you know, saying like, yo, can any, if there's work to, if y'all need work to be done, please take me home. Anyway, it's just a weird little consistency I noticed.
A lover, sing us your love song.
Love song? No, I don't
lover,
have a...
Sing, no. Sing, lover, sing.
This poor guy. Man, Wirt's just going through it this whole show.
Oh, my name is Wirt and his name is Greg. We're related because my mom remarried him and gave birth to him with my stepdad. Can you all give me some directions
okay.
today?
Here we go.
So we can be on our way.
This ain't no love song.
I know what you are. You're a pilgrim.
What? What, like the guys who eat turkey and cranberry sauce?
No, you're a pilgrim.
The master of your own destiny.
The hero of his own story.
I'm pausing a lot in this episode, but I'm noticing more and more things, and I'm really glad I started off by talking about the two kinds of protagonists and the two kinds of stories, and how this is like Wirt is a very passive protagonist. He's just kind of going along, reacting to things happening to him, but they all are seeing him as, mistakenly, as an active protagonist, as a pilgrim, someone who's going off trying to find something. Also, another weird thing, like, it's only Wirt that's like mentioning things that like feels like they belong in the present, like looking for a phone that I mentioned. He said, pilgrims, they're the ones that eat, that dress up and eat turkeys for Thanksgiving, right? Like in this kind of old timey fantasy pre-electricity thing, I don't know if they had that kind of notion about the pilgrims being, you know, the way that we were taught about them being as kids, like around the 1990s or so. I don't know the history of how that was looked back upon, if that was, you know, that whole propaganda thing of like, the pilgrims did no wrong. They didn't wipe out the native population whatsoever. But like, just kind of weird that like, I don't know. It's just another thing that he mentions something that is tying him to like, us and what we know here, whereas everyone here is kind of off the rocker, going off singing, like they all have these old-timey jobs and everything, and I don't know, it's just really weird.
Oh, you guys have heard of the Beast too?
We all know the Ooh. Beast.
Okay, finally, let's get some more information on the Beast.
Seeking those who are far from home, hoping never to let you return.
Alright, this is not, Sarah Stiles, it's not Spinel. Kind of a similar voice. But what if it is, and then now I feel stupid?
Don't believe his lies, fool. He'll turn you to a tree of oil and use you in his lantern for to burn.
Ooh.
Wait, lantern? The woodsman was the guy with the weird lantern, not the Beast.
Pilgrim, he who carries the dark lantern must be the Beast.
What? No. He warned us of the Beast and told us which direction to go to avoid him.
And now you're more lost than ever, huh?
Yeah, but...
That's interesting.
All that compass inside your heart.
No, give him directions, please.
Beatrice!
Go save your friend and get yourself home!
I guess I'm really doing this.
Have they...
Horse, I'm just gonna pretend like I can ride you, all
right? Oh, gosh. That's not a good idea.
Trees.
Ooh.
I told you to leave these woods.
Oh.
Beatrice, you were the Beast all along.
I don't know how I feel about this.
Get Beatrice.
Uh-oh. I dislike this. From both a nature conservation and story perspective.
A weird shadow and then stupidly flew into a tree and got knocked out.
Oh.
Okay.
I did. We just got directions from Fred before you woke up.
Who?
Oh, Beatrice, meet Fred the horse.
Nice to horse your acquaintance.
You can talk?
I told you. I said he was gonna talk by the end.
You're running out of oil, woodsman. Why not let me take the lantern for a while?
Be gone, Beast! I fought you for the lantern before.
Oh.
I'll fight you again.
No need for violence, woodsman, but be sure to keep it lit, or your daughter's flame will go out.
Oh.
Forever. Now, What direction did those children go?
Whew, that was a place to get to. Let me just scooch back over here. Wow, okay, so after that kind of light episode 3, episode 4 stuff got real. I was wondering how... Oh, Penn Ward worked on this. Awesome. I just noticed that. I have it paused on the written and storyboarded by, so that's real cool. Man, there's a lot to take in here. I guess I'll close my opening statement by... I was talking about that this is... And I think I paused to mention this, so I'll be real brief here, about Wirt being a passive protagonist. But it seems like the more it's going on, he's morphing. Like, they saw him as an active protagonist, and now we see him taking charge. He, like, hopped on the horse, grabbed the lantern, grabbed his brother, saved Beatrice, and got out of there. He's becoming an active protagonist. I'm wondering if we ever get to this Adelaide of the Woods, and she kind of explains what's going on, he might go after the beast to try to, like, fix everything. And that would be a really cool shift to see from a passive, just trying to get home, like lost, just kind of reacting to what goes on, to actually like going off to do something, to do good, would be an interesting shift. I was also just wondering how this was gonna work, this kind of the show's structure. Usually when you have like a full season of a show, like a 20 episode run, you know that like right around episode 10, right around the midway point is when like stuff is gonna like really start like popping off, and then it'll like get slower again and then build back up for the season finale. A lot of shows have this this format and layout, but with this one being only 10 episodes long, telling a full self-contained story, I was wondering if we were going to see that kind of act one and act two structure, or if we were going to see it more in like, you know, a three act structure with like little 3 episode chunks with like a 10th episode climax or denouement, so to speak. But it seems like we're getting closer to that. This episode 4 is when we got really kind of the end of act 1 kind of knowledge bomb dropped on us. And what a bomb it was. We see the woodsman again. He is the beast, perhaps. He has a daughter that he is trying to save by keeping the lantern lit, but the beast wants the lantern back. He won the lantern from the beast, which makes him the beast, but the beast is still the beast. It's confusing. I know we're going to learn more. We're just learning about this, but like, it went in a direction that I wasn't expecting. I mean, I know I probably should have expected some kind of like running through line plot kind of thing because of how well the show's regarded, but especially after that 3rd episode and the start of this one even, I was kind of thinking that, you know, this show is going to end up being like they go to a place, they do a thing happens to them, they move on. Kind of like I mentioned the 80s adventure movie, like your Labyrinth or your Princess Bride, things like that. Go to a place, meet a quirky character, a quirky situation, get through it, move on. It's a tried and true formula. That's why it's, you know, popular and enduring. But here at the end, this last, like, I don't think I said anything for the last like minute and a half of this episode. This might have been my least favorite one so far up until that point, at which point it like skyrocketed it in terms of my enjoyment. Like I said, creepy, you bring in the creepy horror stuff back, that's when I start to really like it. But I'm really, really curious to see where it goes from here, especially now. Wirt was a character I like didn't care about because I felt like he was going to be kind of a static character, but now I'm seeing that he has the potential to be like a big dynamic character, and now I'm a lot more interested in him. I still don't know anything about Beatrice. Greg, I think, is just gonna end up being comic relief throughout the whole thing. I love Greg. He's a perfect little boy. Never change. But now I feel like I'm more focused on the main group as a whole now, as opposed to just a couple of the individual parts. But, man, I just hope they stop coming for my boy. Like, everyone is coming for Wirt. Beatrice, all the people immediately getting thrown in the dunce corner in the school one. I think he's going to overcome that. I think he's got great things ahead of him. And I can't wait to see what happens next. But that is it for today. Episodes 3 and 4 finished. Next time, we will watch episodes 5 and 6. We'll officially meet and cross the halfway point of the series. So I'd like to thank you all once again for joining me as I'm experiencing the show for the first time. I am loving it. Absolutely can't wait to watch more and see what happens next. So I think I mentioned all the social media plugs at the beginning. Please like this video and subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already. Both of those things would help me out a ton. And other than that, social media stuff, like I said, and check out another video if you haven't already. Check out some of the Hell of a Boss ones if you haven't seen those. I'm pretty proud of those. And hey, as always, just leave comments letting me know other stuff you'd like to see me tackle in the future. Always looking for new stuff to add to the queue, so to speak. And then hopefully maybe someday putting out more than one reaction video a week. But as of right now, that's where it's going to sit. And so anyway, thank you again for joining me. And I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day.